Let me start by giving a brief introduction of one of my my favorite people, and I don't say that lightly. At this point in life, you know, at your age, you want to be independent, right? You want to be independent from your parents. You want to make some money. You want to be on your own. And we went through that stage, and it's a great stage. You know, you're driven. You're focused. As you get older in life, I think, and you reflect, you want to be interdependent. You want to be interdependent with people that inspire you, that you can learn from, that are great advisors to you, and that sort of share, you know, values and things you want to do. And Ben is someone that I really appreciate having in my life as a friend. We always like to start with someone who will get you thinking about entrepreneurship, about forging an original path and living a meaningful life. And Ben is one of those entrepreneurs who sees things differently and has done it multiple times. He's the founder and CEO of Cypress Creek Renewables, whose mission is very simple: to put as much solar in the ground as possible, because they believe that solar power makes the world cleaner and safer. We'll dive deeper into that mission and the business. He also remains a principal owner and board member of the direct marketing behemoth guthy-renker, where he served as president and CEO from 2000 to 2013. When he joined guthy-renker, the company was doing under $30 million in revenue. When he left a couple years ago as the active CEO, they were doing close to $2 billion. That's growth. And by the way, he joined guthy-renker by making them a very unique offer, one that you could make at this point in your lives if you wanted. Under his leadership, guthy-renker introduced an incredible string of products, many pairing a celebrity, a very good-looking celebrity usually, and a product. Some before your time, Perfect Smile with Vanna White, Principal Secret with Victoria's Secret, Meaningful Beauty with Cindy Crawford, and Proactive with nearly every celebrity on the planet at some point. If you've been around this series recently, you've seen Gary Vaynerchuk, Cindy Crawford, Tony Robbins, and the mini concert with Lindsey Buckingham and the USC band. Those are all Ben's friends, and he made those connections for us. And what makes it interesting that he's so active and helpful at USC is that not only did he go to UCLA, hold the hissing, he was the student body president at UCLA, and he's here helping us. After UCLA, he graduated from Harvard Law School and was a star lawyer at a downtown firm. He is active on several boards, including St. John's Hospital and Houlihan Lokey. I've known Ben for a long time, like I said. We were both attorneys in downtown firms and played a lot of basketball together. Maybe his greatest achievement was marrying a brilliant lawyer from my firm and building a beautiful family. This is someone I admire and whose advice I really value. Please welcome Ben Vandebunt. Ben.
Thanks, man.
Good to see you. Welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming on.
Last time Dave had me here was right after Coachella, and there was about half the crowd, and everyone was yawning. So this is good.
You're the perfect opening speaker, you know. And I've felt this in my life. It's like, when we're your age, like, to do a company and launch it, it may seem like there's no alternative. You have to do it, and it happens. To do it multiple times, and you've really anteed up big for this, for Cypress Creek. Have you thought about that, like how hard it is doing second, third, and fourth times?
Yeah, I mean, I think these guys are probably more interested for most of them is the first one.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I think for me, look, when he was talking about the drive you have, for me, I'm just driven by insecurity, doubt, total lack of confidence. The loop that goes through your head, you know, mine is always, God, you're such an idiot. Like, what are you thinking? And so after I left guthy-renker, I had this real feeling of like, I did really well, but I did really well and I had a team, and Guthy and Renker founded the company. They're the primary owners. And so I think, again, just sort of driven by like, they really did that. I mean, I did some things too, but, you know, I should try to do, you know. So just, I think it's just I just wanted to keep doing something different.
Well, we're gonna go through sort of that path. What he antes up right away in terms of like, everybody that knows Ben sees Ben in a way that apparently he doesn't. I mean, I know at some level you do, but just that he will. I always thought, you know, when you're successful, you got to get over your insecurities and you got to sort of have that confidence all the time and your self-talk is dialed in. And then, you know, like we start talking and he's so honest. Like, so all of a sudden you feel like, holy shit, I'm not alone. I'm not the only guy who feels his insecurities. It happens throughout your life. It gets better.
Yeah.
And you know how to manage it. But you've always been so forthright about that.
Well, don't you think, I was like, you guys all have families and you know families, and I think there's two kinds of families. There's those that are incredibly weird and those you don't know well, right? You know, there's, you know, it's the same with people. Like, you know, I mean, we, especially in an entrepreneurial class, I think it's important for some of your guests to disarm themselves. Because otherwise, it's just kind of too intimidating. Like, you know, Dave brings in, hello, this week is Mr. Fabulous. Let's talk about how wealthy he is and his plane. And next week, someone's extraordinary, you know. And I just think it's really intimidating if you meet people who feel inaccessible. You know, trust me, every one of the guests that came today, you know, is here, has some combination of incredible luck. You know, of course they have ability. Timing, probably an incredible entrepreneurial spirit, all of which you guys have by joining this class and can develop if you want. And so I just think it's just more a matter of, it's not, there's a lot of luck, but it's not that hard. I mean, there's no formula saying if you do these three things, you're guaranteed to have X. But I do think the accessibility issue is a big one. I hated meeting people who just like, wow, you're better looking than me, you're smarter, you're richer, you thought of things I could never think of. It made me not want to do it. You know, that's the standard, I'm out. You know, so so when you realize how low the standard is, I think you'll be excited to be an entrepreneur.
And a lot of these things that you hear, you know, the years go by quickly, they are sort of instilled early in life, and some of the things that we'll talk about, so we do cover people's lives and not just their companies. So starting quickly from the beginning, where were you born? How big of a family? And
I feel like,
and where'd you spend your childhood?
Yeah. So I was born in New York. My parents are immigrants from the Netherlands, so we moved a lot. My dad spoke 10 languages. So the good thing was is that means he always got the international job. The bad news was that it meant he switched jobs all the time. So I moved to Beirut, Lebanon for a while. Then we lived in Europe for a little bit, and then California. And I went to high school in Philly, went to college at UCLA, went back to grad school at Harvard, and then came back here and settled.
And brothers and sisters?
I'm the youngest of four.
Youngest of five. And what did your parents do for work?
My dad was in the airline industry, and he had an extraordinary capacity to lose his job every 3 or 4 years. And the good news was he didn't do it out of incompetence. He did it out of being a bit difficult, which is probably why I try to immediately, hey, how do I make this really comfortable for everyone so you don't fire me off this chair in 10 minutes? So,
and that did sort of plant some seeds of sort of whether you wanted to be an entrepreneur or work for somebody. Can you sort of give us your thoughts on working for somebody, and,
sure.
You know, collecting a W-2 versus
right.
starting something?
Well, I think you
something.
And I both started, you know, we didn't know what we wanted to do, right? I mean, I knew I was going to college when I was in your situation. I knew I wanted to work for myself. I knew I liked money more than I was willing to admit to other people. But I didn't know what to do. In college, I saw a parking lot in Westwood where the owner, it just didn't seem like there was enough cars in it during the day. So I went to the owner and said, hey, how much do you make a day? The guy said like 65, 70 bucks. I said, all right, I'll make a deal. I'll pay you 70 bucks a day if you just let me park. All your guys will be able to park here, but I'll take all the extra revenue and I'll treat your customers really well. I'll even wash your cars if you want. And it was kind of cool. So I was in a fraternity and I ended up hiring guys in the fraternity. We took tips, washed cars, and I was probably generating 250, 300 bucks a day. Pay that guy 70, pay my fraternity brothers, you know, some money. It was a great place in Westwood on Westwood Boulevard, so we got to meet girls. So it just made me like, this is so much better than work. You know, I mean, I remember just thinking, God, I was just like cleaning, you know, kitchens and bussing tables, which was fine. You know, I don't mind work. It's just like, this was fun. You know, and just by being a little clever, it just sort of gave me a taste that, you know, there's more to it. But then I went to college, you know, and like you guys, some of you guys will have big debt. And so I ended up, you know, going to a law firm, but always with in the back of my mind that, yeah, this sucks.
Well, we'll get to that in a second. And what about sort of childhood? You know, a lot of the things and insecurities we face as kids really are deeply branded right. into us and what right. we think about ourselves. And it's funny, you know, there's still an 18-year-old inside a lot of us sort of right. talking to us. Any like childhood sure. adversity that he covered?
That's a leading question. He knows what the... My wife, who's Jewish, is allowed to say this. She says, I'm a 5'1" neurotic Jewish man trapped in someone else's body. And the way that comes is when I was 12, I developed some physical, you know, and now it's not that big a deal, but really bad things with my knee. That Osgood slaughter, I mean, painful, wasn't bad on a serious scale. And so I gained some weight, which was great. And then a lot of weight. And then I developed a learning disability. And I always felt reasonably confident growing up, and then all of a sudden, wow, this kind of not so such a great way to be 12 or 13. And then we moved. So I moved from California to Pennsylvania, and I show up, hey, it's eighth grade. And I, because I lived in Beirut and I had skipped a grade, so I'm 2 years younger than everyone in my class. My voice has not changed. I do not have a hair on my body other than on top of my head. You know, I'm 40 pounds overweight and I've got a learning disability. So I would say my confidence was not at an all-time high. And so, yeah, so I went through a high school experience where I would say I observed it. You know, I don't go to high school reunions. You know, there's some people who I'd like to, whose ass I'd still like to kick. But that's not a good reason to go to a high school reunion. But I think it just really shaped me. I got to watch people behave. And I thought, and I remember at the time thinking, you're not always going to be like this. So just, I don't know, I feel like I treated it as an advantage in my business career, watching other people. And what I, honestly, my biggest observation is, we are all really insecure. And it doesn't matter how cocky someone seems, underneath there is somebody who's vulnerable in some way. And obviously the best way to connect with somebody is if you show your vulnerability, you know, and they're a little vulnerable. I mean, look, you can see two dogs walk up to each other, right? One sticks his neck out, and the other one doesn't want to tear the dog's head off anymore. And I think it's sort of that way with people. And I think a lot of that came from the, you know, that experience, you know, when I was younger.
It is disarming, and it also sort of lets you know that it's okay to be human and share. Yeah. And it actually brings you closer with your friends
yeah,
when you actually
I
share
hope so.
Those things. Because there's a lot of your friends are thinking the same thing. I've had the same thing happen. You know, when you share something that's really, you know, what you perceive as a weakness or insecurity, they just feel like, wow, I have those too.
Right.
And so it's okay to be that way. Yeah. And a lot, you know, there are a lot of people that look up to you, so it's helpful. So you graduate from Harvard Law School, you go to Allen Matkins. You're a fine young attorney downtown. That's where we met. You know, we were like going to political events and land use events. And from the moment I met you, you're like, I gotta get the hell out of here. And I actually enjoyed practicing law until all these friends kept telling me, oh, it's sucking the life out of me, and this is no good, and we can make more money. I was thrilled to do it. Tell us, and you'll see this a lot, like people who hustle and just find an opportunity. Maybe it's not a business, but an opportunity. Tell us about the fire hydrant fee you discovered and how you exploited that. And exploit's the
yeah.
right word.
Yeah, so I was working at a law firm, and John McKay, J.K. McKay, I hope you guys like him still. He's he works in the athletic department. He's a real good friend of mine. Worked at Allen Matkins. And I remember, oh, wow, your dad's his coach. The first day of work, I walked up to him. He told the story. I didn't remember saying it. I said, hey, I just wanted to meet you because this is my first day, but I'm not going to be here long. And so I think I brought that. That, by the way, I would not advise you as you begin a new job. That, you know, that wasn't smart. But what I think helped was that I really looked at, like, what can I do? This is great. I'm learning stuff. But what else can I do? And I think when you're, unless you're Evan Spee, I mean, obviously some of you have great ideas and you can build a business. I wasn't smart enough to build a business. And so the way I exercised my entrepreneur muscle was just looking for opportunities. So I remember just saying, you know, I'm going to go out and like help people. The market was hot. I'm going to help people buy houses. So, you know, I was trying to get some commissions, and I went out with a bunch of people to look at houses. And I really, you know, I'm not really that good at this. You know, like, oh, this is great curtains. I mean, I didn't know anything about houses. I had some really embarrassing conversations with some housewives. So I'm like, oh, this isn't for me. And so one night I was researching a case that someone had appealed to the California appellate court, and the city of LA lost. And what the city lost was that they were charging 1% of a building permit as a fee, whether you were building a building 2 feet from the fire hydrant, you know, water main, so you know it cost $5 to hook up, or if you were in Santa Clarita and you were 20 miles. And the city lost on the theory that that's crazy. You can't charge this guy the same price as that woman. You know, their costs are totally different. So I thought, this will be interesting. I wonder how the city changes the law. This is before the internet and all this. So I look up in the municipal code and it says, we're going to keep, you know, it just says charging 1%. There's a little footnote and it says, if somebody asks for a refund within 365 days of paying, we'll give them a refund. So my thought was, why don't I call these people on the 360-day anniversary of that fee they paid and say, I'm going to get you a ton of money if you give me a big chunk of it. And of course, the first person I went to, they said, what are you going to do? And I told them, and he said, oh, okay, great, I don't need you. So my business turned into contacting these people and taking 30% of their fire hydrant fee as a refund. And so I was out of law school, $90,000, $100,000 in debt, and I'm making $42,000 a year. We're working constantly. And I made like $350,000 in a year working 5 minutes a week. I'm like, this is really good. But then the city changed the rule. They got sick of me. So they stopped charging people because I was processing every one. Hey, you know. And so what I learned, what Dave just taught you, I didn't know, there's an enormous difference between an opportunity and a business. An opportunity is something where you can make money. A business is you're not one little rule change away from going under. So, I mean, I was done. I had nothing, you know. So I was back to my law job, which I didn't like.
And when you started looking for something to, for a new career after law, I want you to share the prism through which you looked at it, because I think it's really helpful. But first of all, you got some advice from your father-in-law.
Yeah, no.
You
no.
can give the edited right, version. What did he tell you in
Am
terms
I
of like?
Am I allowed to say it as blunt as he did?
So my
wife's father was a great lawyer, and he always told me, you're going to be awful. You'll be a terrible lawyer. Don't do this. But he also had great advice, and I think Gary Vaynerchuk, who came last year, said the same thing. And it basically boiled down to this. You have to audit yourself. On one end of the spectrum is a rabid psycho entrepreneur, and we all know who they are. They're the people who have no structure. You know, I mean, half the time they're spilling on themselves. There's very little manners, you know, but they're just all in. You know, I just did two all-nighters. You know, and then on the other end, you have your friends who are going to go work for Ernst & Young, you know, and look, we all fall somewhere on the spectrum of who we are, and, you know, and we have room to grow different ways, but you kind of got to stay somewhat true to where you are. And so my father-in-law said, and I will give the unedited version, because he's a very formal man, but he was very afraid I was going to make an enormous mistake which would hurt his daughter. So he said, let's just be really clear. You're a bit of a pussy. Do not quit your job, right? I mean, you're over here. You're like, you're almost entrepreneur. You're almost that guy. So what I want you to do is I want you to look for someone who is that person. I want you to find someone who's the most entrepreneurial, crazy person that you know, who has a business, but they can't function well enough without you, and that you can bring them real value. So that became the way in which I looked at every single opportunity for like the next year, year and a half. I would look around for opportunity and say, hey, can I add value? No, that guy, he's got his act together. You know, I don't want to work with him. I'm not going to add any value. Well, that guy, she's a disaster. That's my kind of woman. I need someone who's a mess, but who's around a business that's got scale opportunity. So that was really the way. So I spent a lot of time just looking for that.
I wish I had similar advice, because it really is something. Because when you think about being an entrepreneur, you have that image of like, you know, I got to start this on my own or with a partner. It's got to be from scratch. And Gary made the comment too, like the narrative out there, and you know, the popular culture is you have to be the number one. You have to be the founder. You have to be the idea person. That's not true. It's tough to find a good idea or create a good idea. Let's find people, you know, I mean, team with people who are, or a company that's sort of getting into second gear. You can make a lot of money and be really successful and be creative and do a lot of things that we're going to cover, like Ben did, with somebody else's base. They've already got they've already got revenue. They've got products. They've got customers. I mean, that's so hard to create, to get it from zero to one, you know, Peter Thiel would say. And then getting it from 1 to 100. So you were out looking for an opportunity that could grow. And you started, you approached guthy-renker. You saw Tony Robbins, and right. Tell us how this sort of developed.
So, you know, again, it's it was kind of constant. Like everything I would do, I would look at, like, is this something that I can be an entrepreneur on? And so I was watching a Tony, I don't know, do you guys, Tony Robbins still relevant? He's a big guy, self-help. And so I was looking for, you know, for something like that. And I saw a Tony Robbins infomercial. And so I was just looking for him. I just was trying to figure out, how do I meet this guy? And I was just going to, you know, fall down on my knees and tell him, I'm going to work for you. I'll work for you for free. And in the process of trying to meet Tony Robbins, I met guthy-renker, two guys that own the rights to Awaken the Giant Within. And so, you know, so I went to them when I met them, and they're like, hey, well, you know, what do you do? I said, oh, I'm a lawyer. They go, oh, you know, we don't really need any help. I said, I'll make you a deal. I'll work for free, and you got a year. But after a year, if you want to keep me, I'm your third partner. But you can fire me anytime you want. But if I stay a year, I'm only staying if I become a partner. So that's how I hooked into guthy-renker early on.
You think about that. I'll work here for free, and if I add value, you'll make me a partner. And that's not as rare as you think. It may have not been a year. And by the way, during this year, where's your office?
Oh yeah, no, I drove 140 miles each way, and I did it most days because I just got married. Until I realized my wife didn't really care if I came home, you know, or not. But she was working pretty hard too. So I commuted. They were in Palm Desert, and I lived in West LA, so it was 138.3 miles each way. And you know, the cell phone range was just starting, so I only had it for about 10%, 15% of it. But it was a really interesting thing. I mean, it made me feel like I was struggling like a startup guy, even though the company, you know, had a few employees and. You know, we had a little bit going on.
And when you joined the company, you know, not that it's public, but, you know, around $30 million, that's a sizable company for most companies compared to what it is now. It's small. And how did you make yourself invaluable?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, so again, when you're dealing with people who are really entrepreneurial, this is the part where Dave likes to keep it confidential, but a true entrepreneur wakes up in the morning and looks in the mirror, and what we see is them. What they see is the center of the universe, right? I mean, so a true entrepreneur, you know, has not had their Copernican revelation. You know, you have to be that self-absorbed to be that committed. I mean, it doesn't mean you're a bad person, doesn't mean you're not charitable, doesn't mean you're not, like, you know, gonna go straight to heaven, but you have this overwhelming sense of what you're doing is incredibly important. And not always, but often that you're incredibly important. And so I just found it really easy to just say, you know what, you guys are so good. You are so amazing. Why don't we do this? You do everything that creates new products and makes us money, and I'll just do everything else. I'll do anything you don't like, I will do. So let's just start there, and then, you know, but we've got, you are so valuable that if we can just unleash you, you know, on only things that are productive, imagine how good the business will do. And then just give me all the crap, you know, and that's how I started. And they were very good at handing the crap. It was amazing.
Here's my cousin Jimmy. He wants a job, but you have to make sure he doesn't get one, but he can't be mad at me.
So, you know, that kind of stuff. It was fun.
And obviously the role evolved to where you were creating products and brands and were leading the company as CEO. Tell us what guthy-renker does so they may not understand.
So back when Dave and I were your age, people watched TV. And there weren't that many channels, and at the very, you know, back in the, they didn't cover 24 hours, you know, so if you had a channel, there might be 6 or 8 hours of or someone, you know, like someone playing the national anthem. And so at the time, the idea that you could take your best salesperson to sell a product and do it on 30 minutes television, it was a novel concept. And so our whole idea was we were going to take a great product with a celebrity, you know, to get someone to stop a channel, and a toll-free phone number. We had 50, you know, and lots of toll-free numbers, and we'd just air it on TV, and people would buy our product, and then we'd ship it to them. So we would own the product, we would make the commercial, we'd do everything A to Z, we'd ship the product, and you know, it felt very new and cool until around 2007, at which point I was informed that I'm old and yesterday's news, and no one's watching TV, and you guys couldn't care less about our infomercials. So,
but
for the first 15 years, it was really, I mean, you know, we would stand still and get 20%, you know, increase in revenue just because of the market was growing and the acceptance of what we were doing. It was more legitimate.
But, and But what it did in terms of blocking and tackling and what guthy-renker and you set up was probably the preeminent organization for prospecting, taking orders, telephone service, subscription. I mean, you guys built a model that to this day people use online,
sure.
But you created it through telephones.
We did it offline, yeah. So we did let's say in 2000, it cost $35,000 to buy a 30-minute block on CNBC. We'd have a toll-free number. We'd run a Victoria Principal ad or Cindy Crawford, whatever ad it was. And we'd say, okay, we spent $32,000 to buy that. Oh, look, on this toll-free number, we took $80,000 in sales. That's enough for us to make a profit, you know, to pay the media, pay for the product, ship it. And we just did that over and over and over again on, you know, thousands and thousands of different stations. And then we probably were a little slow on the web. Is again, if you, some of you take marketing classes, when you give a customer a choice, they typically choose, you get A or B. You want to call us or do you want to go online? Well, in 2000, our customers actually, we sold less if we put a web address on our ads. And so that made us a little reluctant to embrace the internet, you know, just because, wow, it's depressing our sales, not quite realizing, you know, well, that was a bit of a mistake. So we were a little behind on that for a few years. But anyway, that's how the whole business works. You create an ad, you develop techniques to cause a response. Infomercials are pretty obnoxious for a reason. Call now. If you call now, we'll give you 2 gifts. If you act in the next 10 minutes, you'll be really special. We'll give you a certificate. Oh, and by the way, we don't have that many of these products. So we're selling urgency. We're selling scarcity. You know, you're doing the basic Aristotle, you know, ethos, pathos, logos things, but you're doing it in a modern way in order to trigger an emotional response to get them to buy your thing. And we had to create a lot of urgency. But so it was fun. So we learned a lot about what people wanted, what they responded to. And had we been, you know, we preceded Amazon. You know, we had better systems than Amazon. So, you know, you just think about, had we been smarter, what we could have done. But trust me, I was there. We didn't come close to seeing that. Booksellers.
But you did sort of build a subscription business that, you know, to this day is a model for others. Give us a couple examples of the brands that you built, and then we're going to dive in on Proactive in a second.
Okay. So Katie Rodan, who I think has also spoken here, we found 2 dermatologists. So they
the other ones.
Okay. So they created Proactive. That was our biggest one. Principal Secret, you guys are Victoria Principal. He called it to show you where his head is. He called her Victoria's Secret.
Did I say that?
Yeah. So, but Victoria Principal was the star of a TV show called Dallas. People Magazine called her the most beautiful, or one of the 10 most beautiful women of the year. I think she might have been number one. And she had a real interest in skincare. So we teamed her up with a, you know, esthetician, and said, you know, back then, early 90s, you know, she's a beautiful woman. She has she can choose any beautiful, you know, any beauty product she wants. This is her secret. This is what we do. So we basically democratized Hollywood. We made it accessible. And so that's a model that we followed with Cindy Crawford with a product called Meaningful Beauty. You know, we had Tony Robbins. We sold a bunch of exercise equipment, which tend to be a bit more faddish. We have a hair care line called Wen Cleansing Conditioner. You shouldn't be shampooing. There's phosphates in there. So we've had a whole series of products, just trying to build various brands or a bunch more, you know, vitamin. And, you know, you just learn a lot, you know, when you get into those worlds. You get to learn what people want, what they like, what they don't like. We had a ton of failures in there as well.
And I wanted to sort of talk about Proactive a little bit. I met Katie Rodan, not through Ben, ironically, but Ben's reach is everywhere. I was on a safari in Africa. In a vehicle when I met Katie and her husband, and just said, you know, what do you do? And she said, I'm in skincare, like, you know, understated opinion. And then she says, I have a company called Proactive. Oh my God, do you know my friend Ben? And so I think we may have Katie. Is Katie available to join us? Hey, Katie.
Hi.
Hey, look who's there.
Hi, surprise.
Hey.
We're gonna wow. Can you put it on the main screen? Can you see us yet? There you go. Hello, Katie. How are you?
I am good. I'm doing great.
It's good to see you.
But how are you guys doing? And Ben, I've missed you.
I miss you too.
How long's it been?
How long has it been since we've seen each other?
Two or three years.
Maybe a year or two.
Yeah.
Whatever it is.
Can you see handsome Ben in the background there?
I can see handsome Ben. I can see handsome David, you know. And I just wish I was there in the audience so I could hear what Ben's been up to.
Well, he's up to big things. We'll fill you in. And we definitely have to get you back here. But I wanted to talk for a few minutes about Proactive and introduce this story because it really is pretty spectacular. Katie is an MD, a dermatologist, and had developed a product with a partner and got it to a point where it was really all in. You had this meeting and this pitch. You made a video in front of a fireplace. I remember the whole story. And you were ready to pitch Neutrogena because that was the be-all, end-all, perfect partner for you. Tell us how that went.
Well, you know, initially we thought it was going great. They seemed really interested and we had many meetings with them. And then the CEO dropped this bombshell. He said, I know how you're going to sell this product. And we, you know, said, yeah, we're going to sell it with you guys on a drugstore shelf. And he said, no, you're going to sell it on an infomercial. So my reaction was, oh my gosh, he's insulting us, you know? And I replied to him, Alan, we're good girls. We went to Stanford. We would never do an infomercial. Just take our product. If you don't like the name, you could change it, whatever. We just really wanted Neutrogena to take us on. And he said, no, you're taking it the wrong way. I bet you haven't really even watched infomercials lately because there are some really great ones out there. Take a look at Victoria Principal's infomercial. There's a company called guthy-renker and they do it really well. And if we take you, if we take your product on, we want you and your partner, Dr. Kathy Fields, to go on TV because you really need to explain this product. And he was absolutely right. You know, he's one of those guys in the industry, like E.F. Hutton, you know, when he talks, you listen. And he was absolutely right. And then what happened? Neutrogena, about 2 weeks later, we were all excited. We did our homework. We knew all about infomercials. We were raring to go. He called and he said, I'm sorry, we're going to pass on the opportunity. And so, of course, I was devastated. I thought, Neutrogena is going to steal all of our ideas. They're going to take everything. They were just playing us. They're going to run with this. And we just thought it was curtains because we had no money, no other resources. And so what happened was my parents happened to be at a judge's conference because my dad is a federal judge. And my mom is talking to one of the judge's wives who asked what my partner and I are up to. And my mom tells her that we had an acne product we were trying to sell to Neutrogena. And she replied, Katie should meet my nephew, Greg Ranker, who makes infomercials. And that's what happened. So imagine that. And it was just a match made in heaven.
And Ben, well, we may have to mute this. Ben, what was it about the product and about Katie and Kathy that stood out that made, because you see so many pitches, you see so many products, you only take things that you see can really scale with big markets. What stood out about them and the product?
Well, this is probably, you know, so yeah, it's funny, Katie, just how we all have different memories of how these things work out. On our side, we were looking to do an acne product. And we had seen Atita Carr explain her product, Acne Statin. So we were actively looking, and I had actually come really close, I think with a lawyer, was a good friend of Dave's, with this guy's Dr. Gunter. Do you remember them?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So we were
almost Gunterized.
Yes. Yeah, so we, and so Dr. Gunter has a, I'm sure he's a great doctor, but they're, in retrospect, we didn't know it at the time, had a far inferior product to what, you know, Dr. Rodan and Fields had created, but we didn't know. We sat there internally and say, look at these hot women from Stanford. They'll be perfect for TV. And and we honestly didn't know how good Proactive was when we signed up the deal. It really was like, wow, these guys, they're entrepreneurial, they're perfect for television, you know, they're articulate, it's a lot of television successes, people you want to see and hear. And it just felt like, wow, this is really, really excellent. So we had to kind of unravel another opportunity to quickly pursue this one that, you know, came our way.
And Katie, explain how you originally looked at the acne market and how, you know, you thought it was more niche, and then how you came to understand a larger market with guthy-renker.
Well, this had to do a lot with positioning. And, you know, for what a lot of people in the class don't realize, because you've grown up with three-step acne systems, is that that did not exist before Proactive. Before Proactive, all you could buy was a spot treatment that you put on a single pimple to dry it up, to clear it up maybe a day or two faster, but ended up chasing these pimples around your face. It would be like a dentist telling you just brush the tooth that has the cavity rather than treat the whole face, because acne is about prevention. So that did not exist. And so we were trying to think of how are we going to position this product, which can be a very difficult question to answer. And we hired this Costa Rican marketing consultant who talked about flipping the tortilla. And what he meant by that was, he said, if you look at the acne market is about, at that point in time, was about $250 million total sales, which was very minuscule, very small opportunity. We thought it was big, but he thought it was small. He said, but let's look at the skincare market. And the skincare market was many billions of dollars. And he said, instead of having an acne product, you really have a skincare system that is medicated that happens to treat acne. So it's flipping the tortilla, looking at it differently, and rather than putting it in this very small niche category, we broadened it out. And, you know, listen, I have to hand it to Ben. Thanks to the brilliance of guthy-renker and how they marketed this and how they allowed us to really tell the story of what the product does meant everything to the success. Because had Neutrogena taken this on, I bet, you know, it would have been just a tiny little product, one of many of their products.
And as a footnote to the Neutrogena story, didn't they circle back with you, I don't know how long later, and said it was the biggest mistake they've ever made, didn't they say so?
Here was the good thing. And Ben was so smart about this, because I remember him saying, you know, we would read all about these other acne products, and they were getting a lot more, say, printed press in women's magazines. And it would be like, why aren't we getting that? And why aren't we talking about how big we are? And he said, no, it's good, because we're under radar. Our numbers, because we're a private company and we're an infomercial, those numbers, those dollar sales are not being reported. So no one is noticing us. So Neutrogena had no inkling how big Proactive had gotten until maybe 6 or 7 years into our life selling it. And once they did, we already had first movers advantage and had a huge market share that they couldn't really break into. So it was, it was just such a lucky thing, you know, really, you know, if I could say anything, it's just keep your mind open, because you never know where it's going to take you. And, you know, when one door shuts, another one really can open.
It's funny that, you know, you're familiar with unicorns online, you know, the Facebooks and Twitters and Instagram. I mean, this truly is a brand that is an outlier and a unicorn. I think what was your first year goal for sales? It was like $13 million for year one, that everyone just stood around and said, if we can hit $13 million. Yeah. And again, private company, but Ben, in round numbers, what has Proactive sort of sold?
Oh, and many and many and many of billions of dollars.
Billions of dollars.
Yeah, billions. I mean, many billions. But yeah, to what we were talking about a little earlier before Katie came on. So just look at this. Here you have Stanford doctor, straight out of Central Casting, with truly the best product the market had ever seen. And she still, my guess is they would have done really well without us. But we were talking earlier about finding great partners and that one person who thinks it's all about him or her. So even with an invention and all of this going for them, they benefited a lot by teaming up with somebody, having a partner, not feeling that they had to be, you know, Magellan and doing it themselves. You know, it's a really interesting lesson. I mean, we would never have succeeded in the acne category had we not worked with them. But I think guthy-renker provided a lot to the success that they achieved too.
Oh, it's a perfect partnership. Well, Katie, we know you're still in the office, so that means you're working hard and seeing patients. We'll get you down here for your own night, but I just wanted to thank you for chiming in, saying hi to Ben, and saying hi to the class.
Okay, thanks.
All right.
Great to see everybody. Listen, you can learn a lot from Ben. He is really absolutely sharp cookie. So he's had many, many successes in his career. He's really good at everything he does.
He sure is.
Which is unfair.
Thanks.
And you, the same can be said of you. We will get you down here, and I hope to see you on safari again soon.
Absolutely.
All right. Bye, Katie.
Take care. Bye,
bye
everybody.
Bye. Wave. Thanks. You have to wave. We like to mix it up, as you can tell. Ben's done this a couple times, so what can I do to sort of keep him on his toes
a little bit? Yeah,
that's good. Sure, sixth grade gym teacher.
I was about to start saying off-color stories about the doctors, but I'm so glad you stopped me.
You also made a point, and I think this was helpful when you marketed that brand. And you know, give us an example of some of the celebrities who have been associated and have been spokespeople for Proactive.
So our first one, Judith Light. Who knows Judith Light?
Zero.
Who's the Boss with Tony Danza in the early 90s. And then Vanessa Williams was the first celebrity that some of you would probably recognize that we got to sign on. And that was a big risk for her career. And so what we did is we dealt with it face on. She got on the camera and she said, look, I know you don't expect someone like me to talk, to be in an infomercial and talk about this product, but I have an acne problem and this product really works and this is the best way to sell it. So I'm like, apologies to my agent, but here I am. This is a great product. You know, we paid her $3 million for a day's work. But she was fantastic and really created a lot of credibility for us. And, celebrities are appropriately nervous. They're very entrepreneurial about their careers. So once we got her, we were able to get the two most successful in terms of causing the biggest bump for sales was P. Diddy after he got indicted. I think he got indicted, maybe arrested. Because he was just awesome. I mean, I can't even begin. That is the world's coolest guy. I'm around him, I would just walk into chairs because he's just so much cooler than, it makes me realize what a nerd I am. And Jessica Simpson. And what was really interesting was, we've had Katy Perry, Justin Bieber, Adam Levine now. But what was interesting from a marketing standpoint, if this were a marketing class, this is where we'd spend most of the time. Let's just say Katy Perry and Justin Bieber's celebrity is here. You generate a lot more sales if a celebrity is endorsing your product, going from here to here while they're endorsing your product. Their rise has a bigger value to your brand equity than a big star associating with it. So we had signed Jessica Simpson right about when she and Nick Lachey were, bursting on the scene. Now we had a lot of data that made us feel like Jessica Simpson was going to burst on the scene, but we also had a lot of data about five other people who didn't burst on the scenes, all of whom we paid. And only Jessica popped in that way. And P. Diddy was just special. Like we had you have a shoot, it's $400,000 a day, you got cameras everywhere, you start at 8:30, he shows up at 11:30. Money always matters, but it really mattered then. Hey, Mr. and no one knew what to call him. Hey, Mr. Combs, Mr. John, Mr. Sean John, Mr. Diddy, here's your script. That shit. All right, let's go. And so, you roll the cameras, and I think he spent 15 minutes, and he gave us stuff that we used for 3 years. He goes, I don't call up my friends and say, hey, what are you toning and moisturizing with, bro? We don't have those conversations. But this stuff's really good. And it was just amazing. And then he got hammered one night, and right when YouTube, and I'm sure it's still on there. I haven't looked in a long time. And he just got totally hammered. And he's like, man, and we had signed Lindsay Lohan. We had a few, like Lindsay Lohan and Britney Spears right before she shaved her head. But he was like, Lindsay Lohan, you're late to the party. And he just was hammered. And it was a YouTube thing. And the combination just had incredible value for our brand. Really was. And it was really, that stuff was really fun. You know, and then after like 10 years go by, you know, now it's like, let's talk to Mr. Adam Levine. And Adam Levine's phenomenal. But once you get to be a big brand and people know you, no one cares, right? I mean, it's just boring, right? It's just noise, you know? But when you're building and you're growing, you know, that was a lot of fun.
So, yeah, the point is that, like, you get way more, you know, way more bounce for your brand by taking the ride with a celebrity than just taking, you know, paying Beyonce $20 million to say something.
Exactly.
That's a great. So you joined the company, you know, doing $20, $30 million. You know, we got reconnected sort of towards the end of your tenure when you were antsy as hell. You know, what was bothering you and why did you, and when you leave, you know, it's doing close to $2 billion. So you talk about getting somebody on the growth curve, you know, you created something that is remarkable. What was going on in your mind and why did you decide to leave?
Well, there's four of us that own the business. I didn't like the fact that my three partners really thought that making a lot of money entitled them to enjoy their life. I just felt we had an obligation to just grow the business as much as we could. And I don't know if you guys know Dick Van Dyke was a comedian. We owned all the rights to Dean Martin and Bob Hope and Laugh-In and a bunch of shows. And here's Dick Van Dyke, this iconic guy. And one of my partners in the meeting goes, excuse me, I need to step out, which is fine, you know, people are busy. He steps out, he has a hairdresser come in another room, cuts his hair, and he comes back into the meeting towards the end. You know, we had tennis pros coming to board meetings. We bought, you know, we own a bunch of planes. You know, I'm just not comfortable with that whole, like, you know, and it just made me antsy that we weren't tough. We weren't, you know, I was really felt like we should have been 2 billion, who cares? Let's get to 20. And Guthy and Renker, who own the business, who are like, dude, chill, you know, we're doing great. And then, by the way, I think they're more normal than I am. And so I just felt like I just wanted to leverage it, you know. And so the ultimate disagreement, I think, really came down to, it wasn't a disagreement, it was just, I viewed us as having, we have an ability 10 years ago to acquire a customer, ship them a product anywhere in the world overnight, and put you on a subscription anywhere in the world overnight. To me, I saw that as really friggin' valuable. And I think they really loved, and they're great at being a beauty company. And I didn't want to compete with L'Oreal. It was awesome when Katie, and we used to say the spouting whale gets harpooned. So when Clearasil was sold by P&G, they said, we're the number one acne product in the world. We're three times their size. They didn't even know we existed. I love that. You know, but by the time I was leaving, we had 240 direct competitors in acne. Over 100 mentioned us by name. They were faster than us, cheaper than us, more efficacious than us. L'Oreal spends $1 billion a year in R&D. Our first 10 years at, you know, guthy-renker, we spent zero in R&D. And, you know, and I just didn't feel like over time we could really compete and win. And I really wanted to go into different directions. So I had bought a solar business and a mortgage company, and I wanted to leverage this machine. And I think Guthy and Renker saw us more as a beauty company. And here's a good tip when you're an entrepreneur: if your partners own more than you do, they decide, and you know, as they should. And so I was just getting antsy, and I was the CEO, and I just said, you know, my heart's not in it. I want to start do something different. So that's really what happened.
And that had happened a couple times over the years, and you always seemed to come to an agreement on how to restart or reignite. But this time, I remember you saying, you know, I've got this little solar company, and it was Paramount Solar, and it didn't fit into the guthy-renker model of, you know, beauty products and sort of that. And so you ran with it, and as you left, you sold Paramount Solar to whom?
Oh yeah, this is a fun story. So I'll back up, but it's Elon Musk. But I saw a mortgage company. So again, this is an entrepreneurial insight. I think this is the stuff for me that mattered the most. So I'm meeting mortgage people and I'm meeting solar people. And every time I met a mortgage person, you know, our rates are lower than everybody else's. You know, but they all said the same thing. None of them used infomercials. None of them use the techniques we use. And I thought, what if we applied the techniques we have to a trillion-dollar industry like mortgage? That'd be cool. And then I kept seeing a lot of the same marketing data that showed us that guys are, you know, really think Brooke Burke 10 years ago is really hot, or Jessica Simpson's really going to pop. We have a lot of good marketing data on insights. I saw solar being really interesting because people under 30 viewed clean energy more as a value and not as, you know, they thought it was more important than older people. And so I went to a bunch of solar conferences, and again, I met a bunch of engineers. You know, our solar panels are crisper on the edges, and our inverters operate better, and who cares, right? You know, how do you get, to me, it's how do you get a customer? How do you get people in? And I thought, again, boy, if I could use our tactics and apply it to something other than a beauty product, we could really scale it. And so I bought for guthy-renker, I was the CEO, against the will of my partners. But, you know, you're CEO, you got a few prerogatives. And said, hey, we're buying this mortgage company to have a little solar thing. And then after about a year, my partner's like, what are you doing? It's out of our, you know, you're defocusing us. You're an idiot. This is terrible. I said, you're right. I'll buy you out. And they go, okay, well, you can buy out 80% of us. So I bought them out, mostly, giving me a little more motivation to, you know, to push it a little harder. And so what we did was I went to all the four biggest solar companies and said, you really are an amazing company. Wow, so much better. I could never build what you do. I could never put solar on the roof. Man, are you amazing. But we're really good at acquiring customers. You guys need customers? Because if you need customers, we're really good at that. And so we started getting marketing and selling for four different companies. And then, you know, went to them and said, you know, we're really in a tough spot. You know, my partners don't love this. I got to sell the business. And your biggest competitor wants to buy us, but I like you more. And so I kind of got a fun bidding war going on with four mortgage four solar companies. And Elon Musk owns a company called Solar City. And so they bought, so the whole Solar City business, marketing and sales, is the company that we had. We sold it to them a few years ago, and it went really well.
And when you can tell that Ben is quite a closer when it comes to selling. Your pitch to Elon, I remember, was just like, I've got all these other people interested, but I'm only selling it to you. Tell them how you sort of approach that.
Yeah, so again, that whole idea of staring in the mirror in the morning, he's actually probably the only guy entitled to do that, I think. And I am the same, and I'm right. It's funny, my daughter her best friend's dad is a guy named Jon Favreau, who created Iron Man. And so he's a director. And what's interesting about directors is a lot of them had the same high school experience I did. You know, a good director is someone who observes and is not really a participant, right? They're not typically behind the camera, in front of the camera, they're behind the camera. And so, you know, I knew him a little bit, but, you know, he's a celebrity, I don't want to bother him. I said, hey, you know, I know you're friends with Elon, can you help me? And so he really helped me just figure out, like, you know, what he's like, what he'd want, you know, to do and to sell. And so the whole idea with Elon is, like, look, man, you've got 20,000 customers, you know, we've got 6 million. You know, at some point, Tesla and Solar City have to join the real world. And I mean, because by the way, Tesla infrastructure, I mean, the product's the best I've ever seen, but their customer contact strategy is horrible, and they spend zero on marketing because they don't have to, because Elon's so cool and the product's so good. But eventually, they'll, you know, I'll try to find something to sell them. But, part of it is just like, what does that guy have? And what do I have, and what do I have that he desperately needs? And they believed, and I think they were right, that we weren't the only ones who had it, but we just happened to have it right in front of them, something that would allow them to really exponentially grow.
You gave me some advice when it's rare at my sort of stage of life where I have a peer in a meeting, and he was in a live meeting with a company he invested in. And he gave me some advice. This was in the Hallmark meeting. It's not articulate, but I use it and I give it to other people. And you said, don't edit while seeking. Do you remember that?
Sure.
And tell them what that means, because I do that. Sometimes, tell them what it means.
So, and I got this from Tony Robbins. So if you think about it, if you're in a meeting, if you're forming judgments, what you're not doing is taking things in. And so again, I had the advantage of being in high school. There was zero likelihood anyone in that high school wanted to date me. So when a girl would talk, I could actually listen. I would actually understand what she's saying, and I was unedited by anything other than, okay, I can just observe this. And so if you are actually willing to listen, and listening means you're not sitting there saying, this guy's such a dick, I wonder what he's gonna say next. Yeah, God, I can't wait to get out of here. You know, I don't really want to work with Hallmark. You know, I mean, if you're going through that, you know, while someone's talking to you, you're not taking in all the information that's available to you. And there's plenty of time afterwards to judge and decide and to be a critic of yourself or the other. But you may as well just, in that moment where you have an opportunity, seek what's the best possible outcome here. By the way, most meetings I go to, the best possible outcome is not one I want to act on. But at least I want to know what it is. Let's do the best we can to get there. And I'm sure there's something to learn. And so I think if you, again, it's just, I think it, over time, if you, you know, for someone like me who takes lots of meetings each week, if I do that 20, 30, 50 times a week, I'm a little better at the end of the week than I was at the beginning.
It's great advice, because as you're sort of shaping up alternatives, if you have options, take it to its farthest best point, and don't come up with all the reasons why it can't work and obstacles, and I was doing that in that meeting. It is the best deal, this is the perfect partnership, there's no reason we shouldn't do this, and you can always decide later that it's not. But tee it up, you know, get it to the point where it's actually a viable deal.
Really hard to get a deal done. Hard to buy a company, harder to sell a company. And you and people always say, well, I'm a good person, I don't want to lead them on. There's plenty of ways to get, you know, let's just say I made someone or Dave made someone feel like, hey, we're going to do this deal. Dave can just say, oh, by the way, you know, I forgot to tell you, I have these two other needs.
Yeah.
I mean, there's lots of ways to have deals crater without you preventing you from even having the chance to have a deal. I think it's probably the way to think of it.
And so you sold a Paramount Solar to Solar City, and you joined their board. How did you commemorate that deal with Elon Musk?
Oh yeah. So right about when we were going to close, Solar City said, "Oh, you know, we're going to do what's called a secondary offering." And I go, "Oh, well, what does that mean?" And they go, "Well, it means we have to delay the close like 60 or 75 days, but no problem. We're still excited." Now, if you're a closer, that's like warning. So I'm like, oh my God, this is terrible. I mean, over the next 75 days, they'll see me for the fraud I am. They'll figure out that I'm the 5'1" neurotic Jewish guy not trapped in anyone else's body. I'm that guy. I'm a loser. And they're going to not want to buy us. And this is a disaster. I can't let this happen. And so I thought this was a pretty good idea. So the two guys that run Solar City they're from South Africa, and they are manly men. You know, they're the kind of guys, you know, hey, I went rock climbing naked up Yosemite. You know, I mean, they're just like all man. I mean, I'm a soft guy. They're just all man. And so I rented four Russian MiGs out of Stockton, you know, like the Blue Angels. And so I said, look, I know the deal's going to get delayed, but, you know, why don't we sign everything? But more importantly, I really want people to know how excited we are. So we filmed ourselves, four planes, when we're signing. So I'm here. My buddy's in a plane right here. They're upside down above us, and we're signing the deal, right? And we're videotaping it all. And I'm scared out of my frickin' mind because I hate flying. And so I'm like such a whore for doing this. I'm like, you know, and then we're signing this thing, and then we're flipping and doing twists, and I'm you know, kind of threw up, I passed out, but these guys, this is great! You know, and they're doing all that. But I've got it all on film. Right? And this is awesome. So, of course, what do? I send it to everybody they know. We closed! We signed! Hey, check out how cool these guys are at Solar City! We signed a deal in a Russian MiG! So what does that mean? What it means is they're not going to screw me and they're not going to change the deal 60 days later, because I got to explain to 2,000 people that Russian MiG thing was all a joke. So, I mean, it didn't cost me that much. It cost $22,000. And to me, it was a form of insurance to make sure that they were going to stay and stick to this deal. That's what neurotic people do. By the way, I wouldn't suggest it. I mean, some people are really into that. They let us have the controls. And I didn't, you know, I was like, oh, cool, I'll make a left turn. I'll make a right. These guys are doing bear twisting. And I mean, it was awful.
Yeah, it was awful. It just shows, though, the creativity to put people in a place where they have to say yes, and that is closing. I want to talk about, obviously, your new company. And I think what distinguishes you, in my mind, is that you see big things when they're happening. You, again, observing, right? This observer.
Yeah.
And it's not uncommon when you hear, you know, Paul Orfla, founder of Kinko's, ADHD, hyperactive, dyslexic, couldn't read. He went through his life observing, and he observed lines, and you observed how people react, you observed how people buy. When you decided to go into solar, didn't you ask somebody, tell me when your wife, or do you think it's no longer ugly to put on the roof? What was that, your litmus test as when the market was ready?
Marketing. So I knew that solar was something that people wanted to do just from data. I didn't take a genius to figure that out. And what you know, you're always looking for trend in marketing. You're looking for trendsetters. And so I have a friend who's a super successful architect. And so I just said, hey, tell me when your really rich clients want to put solar on the roof. I mean, it's kind of a simple question. And so like I asked him that probably early, whatever, 15 years ago. And you know, check in with them a couple times a year. Hey, how's it going? People putting solar on the roof? You know, and then you know, like he'd say, you know what's interesting? More and more of my clients are asking about it, but none of them want to, you know, the people who are doing it don't want it seen. That was interesting. Like, yeah, that makes sense. It's kind of ugly. It's blue panels. And so, you know, but I'd keep talking to him. And then one time, you know, he called. He goes, man, the weirdest thing has happened. I go, what's that? He goes, I got 10 houses I'm building over $10 million. All 10 want solar, but all 10 want me to design it so the neighbors can see that they have solar on the roof. That's interesting, right? So think about like a Prius. A Prius is a crappy car. But you, as a driver, are superior to all those gas guzzlers around you. Screw you. I'm morally superior, right? I mean, my car doesn't drive well. It's got limited range. It's slow, but I'm still a better human being than you. So as a marketer, you know, so the idea that people all of a sudden are putting solar on the roof as a statement, that's when I decided to get into rooftop solar. I mean, just that, well, I mean, I was interested, but that insight caused me, okay, I got to go all in. So it was just that kind of a thing.
And going all in on this is a significant investment. You founded it with two partners. Tell us what Cypress Creek does and sort of the status of the company right now.
So the other thing that I did back then, and this is an example of failure, so he doesn't bring it up, but I'll bring it up. My idea was, all right, if I'm going to do rooftop solar, I also want to do bigger utility solar. Like, you know, like think of solar in the desert, right? You know, it's cheaper. You know, it's expensive to get people up on a roof. And so the insight there was when legislation passed where states said your utility buys coal, nuclear, wind, and natural gas, and they then generate electricity and deliver it to their customers. Those utilities are monopolies. You know, they're like your cable company. They control an area. And so when Arnold Schwarzenegger was governor and a bunch of governors in different states said, you know what? We want our utilities to buy a certain percentage of the energy that they create for our citizens, you know, in electricity, we want it to be renewable. I thought, okay, that's interesting. Utility has to buy wind or solar, and I'm already a little interested in solar. And so I started researching that, you know, if you transmit energy from a long place, one place to another, you lose some of the energy. And so I decided to start buying land next to utility outlets, like the plug. Because the land's cheap, right? Who wants the land next to a utility, you know, substation? And I thought if I could build a solar farm on really crappy land that was really cheap and have a 1 foot extension cord, I wouldn't lose much solar. I'd buy the land cheap and I could make it cheaper than other people. And I got to sell it to people who had to buy it from me. So I was like, okay, that's kind of cool. So I started looking at that and I wanted to merge those two companies together. And each had a partner, a CEO, who was like an alpha dog. And they weren't sticking their neck out to see each other. You know, they were like, I'm more manly than you. It was just terrible. And I just didn't want to like spend the rest of my life. So I separated the two. And so the other business, you know, it's where the Cypress Creek came from. So what we basically do is we started off by just taking, you know, we got lots of land, lots of states. And we take underutilized cheap land. You have to get it in some, there's no zoning in Texas, which is beautiful, but you have to get it entitled. Can't have wetlands. We make them. They all got to be identical, and you know, for us to keep make it really cheap, and then we create the energy, and then we sell it to the utility. And the market's gotten so good, and solar panels are so cheap, we actually can sell it to the utility cheaper than what they pay for coal. And so they like us now. So they're not like, oh, here are the guys we have to buy from. And so we enter into long-term contracts. And so we've been able to, we started this about a year and a half ago, so we've raised well over $1 billion in money just to go out and buy. I want to build as much solar as I can and then sell as much as I can to the utility. And, you know, so our mission is, you know, we want to put as much solar in the ground as we can because that way we can shut down as many coal plants as we can. And if we do that, we'll do really well too. But, you know, so that's kind of the idea there.
And I'm running a little late, so I want to get the students to ask you your questions, but you know, watching the State of the Union address last night, and every time I sort of watch the trends, I think of you, and I'm just like, Ben is cheering like a madman right now. Like all these things line up for your business, and ultimately, it may not be delivering it to the utility, right? It may be delivering where solar panels on the roof to battery or storage and used right at the home, right?
Yeah, so Solar City and Tesla, I don't think this is a trade secret, but you know, they're just so cool. They're like, they're just way, they play a bigger game. You know, we've got a, I'm on the board of I was on the board of Solar City. I just left a few months ago because I wouldn't sell my solar company to them. And they're, again, manly men, you know, hey, you're our good friend. We'll buy your company? No, okay, you're out. They are doing really cool stuff. So if you think about the vision of what Tesla and Solar City and battery storage could mean to the world, it's kind of cool. Your car will provide electricity to your home, right? You've got a car, it's got a battery. You could put a battery pack, an extra battery on your house. You've got solar panels on your roof, generates energy all day. They're getting more and more efficient. To the extent you don't need it, it gets stored. To the extent it's stored, you can use it at night. But your delivery vehicle can be your car and the power pack. So these guys are thinking 15, I'm like, you know, looking for that next little opportunity. These guys are changing the world, and then Elon wants to colonize Mars. You know, so they're thinking, you know, a little further ahead. But it's really cool stuff that they're trying to do. My latest thing is that I finally realized that rooftop solar, it costs three times more to install a tiny solar plant on a roof than it does to stick it on the ground. Like, so some, I brought in a crew and didn't have to put them 15 feet up in the air. I can build it cheaper here. And there's more ground than there is roof. And so we created this concept called local solar, and we're launching it in Texas with the idea that Texans hate us, right? Hippie, Californian, green, you know. And if we can succeed there, then I think we can take it nationwide. And the idea, so we're going into communities and saying the first 2,500 of you that will sign up, we will supply 100% of the energy that comes in your home as clean energy, which, by the way, most Texans don't care about. But by the way, we will not only do that, but we'll deduct 10% off your current energy bill, which, by the way, Texans do care about. So we just started that a few months ago, and I think we're going to do a lot of that. And so the idea, we call it local solar, and the idea is, yeah, you know, people's roofs, it's expensive. Not everyone has a roof. We can do this for apartment dwellers, anybody, you know. And so generating energy in the desert is good, but you have a 100-mile extension cord, and you lose a lot of energy. That's a little too far. But putting it on the roof is a little too close. You know, it's many people, only 6.5% of Americans qualify to have something be on the roof, but 100% qualify for local. So can't do it here because the land's too expensive, but in Texas and states where the land is cheap. So we call it local solar, and we try to do it within, you know, a few miles of a community. You know, maybe far enough so they don't have to see it. And then we name it after them, you know, like, you know, or whatever. You know, we're trying to figure out the right, you know, marketing hook on getting that. But we just launched that a few months ago, and that seems to be going pretty well.
And how many people, how many projects right now?
How many projects?
Yeah, how many projects do you have?
So in last year we installed, I see our sites, I can say 332 megawatts. So we build them all in 5 megawatt size or smaller, because if you're bigger, then the utility doesn't have to buy your energy. There's a lot of laws in America to promote small business. So we just do lots of small businesses. Each of them are separately incorporated, which creates some real complexity. So we built each, so a 5 megawatt farm is about 50 acres. And so we did however many of that is, probably 60. 70 of them last year. That was our first full year of business. We hope to about 200 more, you know, those this year. So we, right now we've got the equivalent of 150,000 homes getting their electricity from, you know, renewable energy, and hopefully next year we'll be over 500,000. And then we just want to keep growing it.
Excellent. Questions for Ben? We've got questions. Here you go. I'm going to give you this so it records on the tape.
Thanks.
It's not an amplifier.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, great. So I just had a question. Cypress Creek Renewables, you called it renewables, not solar. So is there a longer end goal there? Do you want to go into wind or biofuel? I mean, what's your...
Originally, we did. You know, we were looking about 4 months ago at looking at some natural gas plants, which is the least dirty of all fossil fuels. But
yes,
we can create solar during the day. And we can buy, the wind typically blows at night and the sun shines during the day, and you have that dawn and dusk period. And so I always thought, like, if I was going to provide a 24-hour solution, we needed to meet. But I think we're just going to stick with solar and then just wholesale clean energy from others. But yeah, so it was probably, and we now typically brand ourselves as either Cypress Creek or Cypress Solar.
And one other quick question. How did you learn what you needed to know to like get into the solar industry? Because I'm not an engineer and solar panels are really complicated. Right. So being able to like sell and market those, what was your secret?
So again, you got to go back to like I knew nothing. I knew nothing. And then I got marketing data that says solar could be a growth area. One thing that we didn't talk about, but I really would encourage you, getting into Hollywood, getting into Wall Street are really competitive. If you want to be a sports general manager, there's 32 of them in baseball. I don't like competitive places. I don't do well when other people are really smart. I would like scale with low competition. And so I'm always looking for what's an opportunity, but I don't want to compete with the Daves and these guys of the world. I want to compete with, like when I got in the infomercial business, used to always joke, there's guys were wearing three pinky rings and no one had a college education. That's where I want to compete. And you go into, I'd like to go in the mailroom of CAA. That's a cesspool of competition. You got smart people, tough people, that's sort of rough. So I think for me, it's like, I'm curious, but again, you got to have a little filter, or I had to have a little filter. So I would always look for what's scalable where I could conceivably win because I'm bringing something to the party. So I would just look at solar. And then I signed up to go to an industry convention, and I didn't understand 90% of what people were saying. You know, inverter, I don't even know what that is. And so just little by little. And so, you know, I think if you're just, it's just kind of a way of thinking. Like if you're really entrepreneurial, you're always thinking of how do you maximize that opportunity? What could you do? So, but I knew nothing. But it's amazing, after a year, you become an expert. In 3 years, you're up here talking to students.
Hey Ben, my name is Zach Kim. So you've had to close a lot of deals over the years, whether you're raising money or you're negotiating a partnership or you're just trying to sell your company. So do you have any tips on how to actually close some of these deals, especially these long-term ones where they could back out any second until they give you the check or actually, you know, go through with this kind of deal?
Yeah, I totally get it. Selling is so much harder than buying, right? Because, you know, when you're buying, you're like, I've got the check. And it doesn't require as much skill. You know, that's why, you know, yeah, so raising money, it would be an example of just trying to close a deal. You know, the only advice I don't know if I have any advice, you know, that's worth anything other than I'm just constantly trying to figure out what the other person wants.
Okay.
And what I can give them that meets their need. And I try to, I'm not a particularly selfless person, but it really helps if you're negotiating with someone. I would constantly say, what is it that you want? What matters to you most? Because I want you to win.
And how often are they straightforward with that?
I'm always that straightforward.
Okay.
I stop with the games long. I mean, like, I really do believe, and if somebody takes advantage of that, I don't want to be in business with them anyway, you know, I mean, but, and you will, by the way, my method will get you screwed a few times along the lines. It's happened a few times. It's okay. That's just, you know, the price of business. I think the opportunities it creates dwarfs the occasional thing. The challenge is when you do things that way I just described, it's really hard to explain to your friends or your wife what you did. You did what? And you didn't have a contract? And you trusted them? Yeah, it happens. So I do think, though, that at the end of the day, likability, meeting other people's needs, thinking about them, because if you're thinking about them, then there's two people in the room who are only thinking about them. And I think that's helpful.
Great, thank you.
Hi, my name is Nicole, and a reoccurring issue in classes and everything like that lately has been like the second time around, like Katie with the rejection from Neutrogena. So I'm guessing, what's the little voice inside of your head that doesn't tell you to stop or that your idea is crap once that moment hits?
Right. Well, it always happens. You know, someone once explained to me that 200 or 2,000 years ago or 5,000 years ago, the person who was standing by a bush and said, you know, I think that might be something there, you know, and then the other person said, oh, I think it's just the wind, right? Well, the person who's just the wind is sort of your easygoing friend, and your neurotic friend is like, oh my God, that might be a lion in there. Well, 5,000 years ago, the person who was neurotic, they're the one who survived because they always viewed it as, hey, there might be a lion, and the easygoing people kind of got eaten out. You know, and so I always just think of it sort of as a Darwinian thing, like, if somebody rejects you, it's really important. They might have a really good reason, and they might be right, but they might not be. And if you get rejected 10 times, or whatever, you might still be right, but you should really be questioning things. And so I get rejected, and I got a lot of give up in me. You know, I mean, like I'm not here to like say I've got the idea, and I mean, I'm constantly listening to rejection, deciding, wow, that hurts, okay, and then. But usually if I can understand why, I can either tack a little bit. Like all these things I'm talking about on solar, I didn't start with any of this where we are now. Started over there. It's all non-linear jumps going in a general direction. But at some point, ideas suck. You know, sometimes you just got to bail and just, move on. But I think a lot of ideas that have merit, can evolve. And I think it's just you just got to figure out for yourself which way. But rejection's a really good thing. You know, I mean, it's hard to take, but I think you can learn a lot. I mean, I have a lot of opportunities in my life now where people will blow smoke up my backside and say, well, you're really doing great. And I don't learn anything from that. But somebody says, you were kind of arrogant in that meeting, or you didn't, you missed this, or I can learn from that.
My name is Matin Merizadeh. I just wanted to know, so when you were working with Guthy and Ranker, how did you guys like structure the setup with like Proactive to sell? Would you guys buy it from Proactive like wholesale, or would you guys work in like a percentage from the back end that you guys would make?
Got it. That's a great question. So we decided early on that we were going to bear 100% of the P&L risk of everything we did. So we actually, Katie created it. She and her partner, they founded it. But they licensed everything to us in an evergreen manner. So we had the contract with the manufacturer. We bore all the risk of bad batches. We assembled it together. We shipped it to the consumer. We did everything. We pay them a royalty. Now, Katie and Kathy, honestly, were so entrepreneurial and so good. I think they were a little frustrated that they didn't have more that they could do. And they were already doing a lot. So they actually created another business, of which they've totally kicked butt on, where they're doing more of that. But I think when I first was looking at various things, buying things at cost, buying things at wholesale, arbitraging that and a retail, it's a great way to start, right? If you don't have a lot of money to begin, if you can find somebody who will bear a little risk and say, let me just buy 500 at cost and I'll show you how it goes. I mean, I think those are all really smart ways to start, your entrepreneurial.
It's not secretive. What was like the royalty fee, if you don't mind me asking?
They have made hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars and they earned all of it, maybe even more. I mean, it's a lot. Again, when there's no competition, the margins were extraordinary. So the part that I can describe to you, this is important. We will, Proactive now sells for $19.95 or $20. We will acquire a customer. We might spend up to $250 to acquire somebody to buy a product from us for $20. And that's because we know that if you're a credit card user with a FICO score over 750 who bought our product after coming from RollsRoyce.com or History, the History Channel, the likelihood is that you're going to buy this product and reorder for a long time. If you are a check payer or a debit card payer worth a lot less than credit card payers, so the point is that we are in a really good margin business. And the best margin businesses are ones where you don't have to sell a product and that ends your relationship. It's hard to develop a relationship with people and with customers. And if you can meet their need over and over, I think there's a lot more money to be made if you can sell a product 10 times to a person than 10 different products to 10 different people. Because the complexity and the cost associated with the additional 9 people often is a big margin killer. So we're very much into subscription, negative option. Our big thing, and you can't do it, it's not nearly as well received as it used to be, is we will ship you this product for the rest of your life until you tell us to stop. And people don't love that so much, but we would always accept the cancel and give them refunds for all that. But very lucrative to be in the subscription continuity businesses, and it's it's validating. If somebody wants to buy your product more than once, it means that you're meeting their need.
And then my next question is just for the solar company that you run. Most of your money is made off rebates, or is it off selling the energy to the like city, or? Just because I'm kind of in that business myself, but for LED lights, so I work a lot like rebates and cash incentives. on the back end, so I just want to know how you set that up.
So every form of energy, because the government has decided that we need energy, is subsidized in some form. So I started off in oil and gas, and when you drill for oil and gas, the government gives you a 35% gross credit. So if I pull $100 of oil out of the ground in Texas, the government gives you $35. And that's because we need the oil. I mean, right now, today we don't, but you know, 150 years ago we did. So every form of energy has a different form of subsidy. In solar, the way it works is that, and it's really obscure, if you are a C Corp, which means you're a corporation either publicly traded or have 35 or more shareholders, and you have a profit, they will permit you to offset your profit with a 30% investment tax credit. So when we build these things, it's not quite as simple as I described. When we build it, I build it for Morgan Stanley, Google, Facebook. They own it for 5 years. They take all the subsidy. I then buy them out after 5 years, but I'm running it the whole time. So there's a lot of very complicated structure. In the business we have, even though we're a startup, we have 12 lawyers and I think 28 structured finance experts. You know, and a bunch of people who are wearing backpacks and guys with man buns who are very environmentally conscious. But it is a little complicated. So the subsidy structure is one that is not that easy to dip into, but is accessible. And obviously, you know, it really helps in the business we're in.
Hi, my name's Matthew. How would your journey change if you didn't study law?
That's interesting. He asked me if, basically, if things would be different if I hadn't gone to law school. You know, I think what helps about law school is you get to feel like you're still doing okay, even though you don't know what you're doing. And I think it's really important, you know, it's what Dave is going to create this extraordinary program at USC. And if you just think about Pete Carroll, Will Ferrell, I mean, these extraordinary outliers, these people who perform incredibly well, so much of it is just it really is an attitude. I don't think there's a formula, but there are ways in which you can get the most out of yourself. And I think for me, having gone to Harvard Law School made me, it made me feel like I didn't have a learning disability. And I guess I knew it, but that kind of validated it a little bit. And so I probably carried myself with a little bit more confidence. And so I think it allowed me to continue to be an absolute screw up. I just had no idea what I wanted to do. And I think that you guys face a real pressure because I didn't have 30-something peers that were billionaires. You know, like I meet so many people in their 20s and they think, man, I gotta get going. And that's bullshit. You guys are all gonna live to be 110. You probably need to slow down. You know, I mean, you're gonna get bored by the time. You imagine the last 30 years of your life, you guys would be bored out of your mind. I think there's a business there. Bored octogenarians. You know, so, but what I think you guys, you know, you gotta do is you gotta find what's right for you. And it's really hard to find what's right for you if you're down on yourself. You know, like, you know, if you watch Shark Tank, people who cry don't get deals. People who are like miserable, you don't go, hey, I'm gonna start a new business. Who's my most miserable friend I can join? You know, join with, you know. So I think if you're feeling good about yourself and you're thinking clearly and you understand that you're at USC and, you know, by the way, in the 80s, this school sucked. But you guys now, it's now genuine. This is like Stanford now. It's amazing what's happened at SC. And you guys have so much to offer and you've got such credibility having gone here. That of course you're gonna feel bad about yourself, but I think if you just carry yourself as, you know, hey, look at me. I genuinely have confidence issues. I'm a bit neurotic. I don't know, when I meet with Elon Musk, I didn't say, hey, you know, did I tell you about my learning disability? You know, I was like, man, you know, you are awesome, but you're missing something big that I can help you with, you know, and you can't do that if you don't have a certain degree of feeling good about yourself. So I would say, yeah, law school was fine. My peer group was amazing. Yeah, that guy's president. That guy, she's the governor of, you know, of Michigan. My best friend is now worth $1 billion. So that was neat. Didn't help me. You know, that probably contributed to the insecurity, but they were interesting to meet. But I think feeling good about yourself, having a belief that this will work out, that, you know, that statistically things are really likely to work out well for all you guys. And if you, you know, and it won't happen linearly. You know, two of you will get lucky tomorrow. Someone's going to win Powerball, you know. But, you know, but it's going to happen like that. And I, you know, and law school is an oasis for the undecided.
Hey Ben. Hi. So I was wondering. You mentioned that the difference between a business and an opportunity is that a business can be. I mean, a business can't be ruined by one rule change. But then you see like startups like Uber and Airbnb. That started by fighting the law. Uber, when it was first running in San Francisco, it was issued a cease and desist by the state of California, and it was told that they could be imprisoned for 3 months for every day they ran. So my question is, like, when do you choose to fight the law, and when do you choose to give up on it?
So I don't, and hopefully, you know, Dave knows all these guys, so hopefully he introduces you to them. But, you know, like the guy who runs Uber, the guy took on the mob in Vegas. I mean, that guy has some brass that I don't have. You know, I would say you can't threaten me, you know, and you can't bribe me, but if you do both, I'm your guy. You know, I'm kidding. But that guy is all, he's got nerve, you know, and so, like, I couldn't change that opportunity. But look, I think you should pursue opportunities. You know, I mean, I'm so glad I made that money and paid off my student debt because it allowed me to reduce my overhead and go work for free. Had I not done that, I mean, that sounds really good. Hey, man, I'll work for free. You know, that was risky. Yeah, but I just made a bunch of money, you know, and so, you know, and I lived in a rent-controlled apartment, and my overhead was low. And by the way, my wife was way more successful than me making money. So I mean, again, I was able to make some of these decisions, but they were rational. But I agree with you. I think FanDuel is a great one. I have a friend who invested in that. Really interesting thing that's going on. People want to do that. If they win, those guys are going to make billions of dollars. If they lose, they're going to lose. You know, the good news is most everyone is spending other people's money, so it's, it makes it easier. But it's a tough call. But I'm not. It's not in me to fight. You know, for that kind of stuff. You know, life is too short. But clearly, the Uber guys, you know, they'll fight anybody.
That's actually the define. Great question. That is the defining characteristic of Uber and Travis. Uber needed a fighter, someone to take on an industry. And if you take on an industry and win, you win huge. Ben, I think I like his approach is like he looks to see which way the wind is blowing and what macro trends favor his business. So when he saw, you know, tell me when solar can go on a roof, that was a good observation. When he, you know, looked for big trends, the regulatory environment right now, in terms of incentives and tax equity, is really favorable for your business. If it changes, you're going to have to adjust. But right now, it's really favorable. So it really is sort of looking at the macro environment. This is our first week. We'll do better on time. We've got a lot more information than time. Ben calls this a parlor trick. He's seen this before. And I'm being risk because we just met. I don't even know what they'll have.
You think they'll do it?
I think they better.
Let me tell the story though.
Tell the story.
So Dave, first of all, you know he's like Oprah, right? I mean he's kind of, he's the coolest guy. And so for me to be able to ask like Tony Robbins or Cindy Crawford to come speak, you know, or Gary last year, or these others, they love it. And one of the things that he did, and it's really cool, and so it's kind of killing some of the, you know, what you're about to do, but so Cindy Crawford is one of the world's amazing women, you know, and I don't think people knew it. Like she was a 4.0 chemical engineering major at Northwestern who just happened to be able to make a lot of money because of the way she looked. And so she spent her life being underestimated and being okay with it because it was part of her business. So for her to be able to come to USC and speak and have Dave treat her with the respect that she's earned and really pull out of her this extraordinarily substantive side of her as she's approaching her 50s was very much a big deal to her, and that was great. And for me, it's terrific, because when you ask someone to do this, you're putting your own credibility on the line. And then Dave gave me the greatest gift of all time, which was asking the students to say to his phone or whatever he was doing, tell me what you just learned from Cindy. And so I'm driving, you know, he shows this, I don't remember where I was, but Cindy, after he sent her the 2-minute video of the feedback that the students gave her, she called me up as if she had just won an Academy Award. She's like, you can't believe what Dave's class did, what they said, what they shared. And it's just a remarkably wonderful thing, you know, for people who, you know, who are first-time speakers, you know, who just don't, you know, who, you know, are a little insecure about speaking. Did you add value? And I just think that Dave and you guys are really lucky, because not only, you know, he's starting with his weakest speaker, you know, you're going to have a remarkable quarter of people of insights. But what he is extraordinary at is pulling out. I mean, I don't talk like this at work. I don't talk like this with my friends. And he just has this weird ability to cause people to share and open up. And it's really awesome.
But the lesson was actually from you, because Cindy Crawford said, you know, she was going from here to Oprah like 2 days later. And she said, I'm more nervous about talking to your class than I am being on Oprah, because it's just not an environment. And Ben made a good point. Find out things that you can do for people that they can't really do for themselves. You know, what is it, you know, Gary Vaynerchuk dropped out of school and never went to college to put him in front of a college class. Maybe that's cool for him. Cindy Crawford, same thing. And so it is a good lesson. Find out what moves people and whether you can give them a unique experience. So, you know, thanks for all the people you've sent our way. We try and give them a good time. We've had some fun. But I want to do the same for Ben, because I actually take notes as well on these things and learn a lot. So I want to hear what you've learned. So what we're going to do is go around the room. I want to see a bunch of hands. 5 years from now, what's the lesson or quote or powerful, just short sound bites of what you remembered or wrote down from Ben's talk tonight? Who's ready? I want to see a bunch of hands. Who's ready? Ready? Okay, I'm going to come around and speak loudly, because it's got to be in here.
Sell an annuity. Find every opportunity and go for it.
Develop a relationship.
Make yourself approachable.
Everyone has insecurities.
Speak. Don't settle when you succeed.
Speak up.
Flipping the tortilla.
Flipping the tortilla from Katie.
You don't have to be the idea guy.
Go where your heart's in it.
Here.
Find out what motivates people and how you can get that to them.
Put people in a place where they have to say yes.
Look for scalable opportunities.
Have an open mind.
Always audit yourself.
Great.
Observe. Lead with vulnerability.
Don't edit while seeking.
Awesome.
Listen to rejections carefully.
Vulnerability is your greatest selling point. Close deals on crazy airplane rides.
Be really, really funny.
Be honest. When you're forming judgments, you have no chance of taking in the information that's being presented to you.
Scale with low competition.
Find where preparation meets opportunity.
Speak up.
It's okay to be vulnerable.
Give people what they want.
Give people what they want.
Both people in a place where they can't see them.
Slow down.
You can function best by observing.
Let's hear it and thank Ben Vandebunt.